Hey, a pleasant good day, everybody. Welcome into the next Sports Fanatic. Welcome into the next Sports Fanatic News Quarterly Report as I'm joined by a special guest, John Off the Wall Hockey. As you can see who we're talking about in the background over his shoulder, we're going to be talking about the Baltimore Bruins today and greatness of their team because they've been a fun team to watch this year. I'll put it that way. Just don't have the same mentality of how they were with the Chara and the cup-winning Bruins were on the ice, but I still think they have a good chance to be successful, but we'll see what John's opinions have. First and foremost, how have you been, John? It's been a while since we talked.
Yeah, I'm doing well, and I appreciate you having me on. This is definitely going to be a lot of fun talk Bruins.
Yeah, no, that's for sure. How I started these out with Deli and other people that I've had on as guests is, if you had two things that were positive, just like off the dome thoughts that you think of your team immediately, two positive thoughts and two negative thoughts, what would be like those two things just to kind of start the podcast kicking?
Well, two negatives are easy. Inconsistency and frustration. Those are two words that immediately come to mind with this Bruins team. Because they've been extremely inconsistent and they haven't been at the level that most of us were expecting them to be this year. On the positive side, I think, you know, your top guys are still lighting it up. Bergeron, Marchand, Pastrnak's kind of had a down year, but McAvoy is stepping up into a huge role as one of the best defensemen in the league. And I think one of the other biggest positives is that, you know, knowing that they haven't played their best hockey yet, you know that they have a new level that they can go to and a new level that they can reach. And if they can get there in the second half of the season, I think we'll kind of forget about the struggles at the beginning of the year if they end the year on a good note and are hot going into the playoffs. So there's definite room for improvement, but I think they're a team that's good enough to get there if they start playing to their potential. And the top guys for Boston are still, you know, the top guys who are going to perform at a high level every game that they're in.
Yeah, and I also think when you have guys like, you bring in guys obviously like Craig Smith, who are a great depth veteran guy that just add a good play to a team in the bottom six role, where if you have to move them to the second line, you can do that too. You have players not having the best overall season, but just in general, when you have players like Eric Halla and then Nick Foligno on your team, it kind of adds a little bit more, what's the word that they use? Oh, Swiss Army knife, like, yeah, mobility on your lineup, that if you have injuries or a COVID season like this, it allows you to slide people a little bit more throughout your lineup. So I think that really does help this team through this season. But something that I think the hockey guy mentioned that had me thinking, because you've had guys like Oscar Steen play three games this year. Frederick's probably played more games than
he
would have. If this wasn't a COVID season. Something that in a positive, because I always like to spin it that way in bad time, that he put on is you have these guys getting opportunities sooner than they probably would have, where what that then allows is them to obviously progress maybe sooner than they would have. So that's a positive way to look at it, because if they do ultimately go back down, now they know what their hardships are that they have to fix to be able to then come back up. Or if they kill it like Jack Drury is in his first couple games of Carolina, if he keeps doing that, then you just keep the kid up. So it actually, I don't know what your take is on that, because I just found that as an interesting point he brought up, because that is kind of a positive way to spin the hardships of the COVID season. These guys kind of maybe being able to figure things out or revive someone's career, even like Austin Zarnik, for example, has looked good with the Islanders when he's been playing. He looked good with Bridgeport all season. You have those opportunities as well.
Yeah, my issue with that is that nobody's come up and killed it. Like, yeah, I think if anything for the Bruins, it makes me sour on their prospect pool even more, because nobody that's coming up looks like an actual NHL player. I mean, they have guys that can fill in a game here and there, but they don't have guys that I'm excited about. They don't have young players that I think are going to step into the lineup and be able to provide any sort of offense or provide any sort of, you know, real good, surprising play. Like, I look around the league and these other teams have 19, 20, 21-year-old kids coming up, and they're immediately having an impact in the lineup. They're scoring goals. They're producing points. They're adding to the offense for their teams. And the Bruins don't have that at all. I mean, the last year and a half for Jack Studnicka has been a huge disappointment. He has not turned into the NHLer that I thought he was going to 2 years ago. He only has 1 point in five games this year. Oscar Steen has been up for three games. He actually has a couple points. He's got a couple assists, but he hasn't scored. Carson Kuhlman's played 18 games this year. He has 2 points. Trent Frederick, he's played a lot this year. He only has three assists. He's played 18 games. He has three assists. That's it for points this year.
Talked about last year too. I remember you and I both talked about how we liked Frederick because he has a little bit of skill, but also has that tenacious side of his game.
Oh yeah.
This far, he hasn't shown. He's shown the tenacity, but he hasn't shown the skill side that you want to see with it. Well, I would say the guy you mentioned in three games, just because of from watching a lot of AHL, his Providence looks. I would say Steen has probably looked the best, but it's too small of a sample size to label somebody when it's only been three games, and his only holdbacks are his size. That's why you've had holdbacks with when people looked at Steen, it was mostly, well, is he going to be able to play to the NHL level? Is his size going to hold up, or is he going to get injured, or is it not going to allow him to get through and get open and all that yada, yada, yada stuff when it comes to him? But your best prospect is probably playing in the World Juniors when it comes to offense, because I'm pretty sure LaSalle made Sweden. So
yes, yeah. He's playing in the WHL this year. We're not going to see him in a Boston uniform at all this season, probably not next year either. I mean, he was just drafted. You're looking at least 2 years out for him, I would think. Again, a lot of these guys that Boston has been calling up are older guys, too. It's not like they're calling up 19-year-olds. Like, these are guys that if they were going to be NHL players, like, are at that age where they need to be NHL players now, and they're not really looking like NHL players. I mean, Studnicka is 22, Frederick is 23, Steen's 23, Kuhlman's 26. These aren't young guys.
I would say Kuhlman's definitely at that age, because like the way from like listening to all these different scout podcasts, especially Craig Eagles, who I really like, like, usually 24 to 27, like, if I was a GM, if you don't hit it in those years, because, like, Ryan Strome's kind of an example you can use of didn't hit it until 26. Like, if you don't hit it by then, like, Kuhlman's where you're getting to the concern territory where I'm like, okay, we got to move on from this guy.
Well, he's just a depth player. He's.
But, like, if you think, like, if he's not even stepping up to that level, like you just said, now you're like, well, we should just go grab a veteran that we know is an AHL veteran that can be used as depth that's more proven, because Carson hasn't stepped up in that capacity either. Where with Frederick, I would say I would give it like another year or two, and then I would make that judgment. Where with Steen, like I said, he's had too small of a sample size, but if he can keep that sample size into another good three games, and then a couple off games mixed in, because you expect that from any young player, then maybe you can start building that up. Because obviously the Bruins, as they're going to trade him, it seems, you're going to want to find somebody that can kind of slide himself in there for DeBrusk as well. So,
yeah, and I mean, just overall, I mean, you've got these guys not really producing much in those mid-20 years where, like, that's kind of the cutoff of where you've got to prove that you're an NHL player. And, like, Carson Kuhlman is fine, I think, is like a 13th or 14th forward, but he shouldn't be a guy that's in a regular in an NHL lineup, at least not on a good team. He has 2 points in 18 games. Frederick, I would like Frederick maybe as like a fourth line center full time, but nothing more than that. He only has 3 points. Anton Bleed has actually been, you know, the best of kind of the no name Bruins that have been called up. Anton Bleed's got 4 points in 12 games. And he's 26 years old. It's not like he's a young prospect anymore either. So
he was on protocol, right? He went like he was getting hot, and then was.
And he is now
on protocol, yeah.
Along with half the rest of the Bruins lineup, but it's just these guys are not proving to be full-time NHL caliber players. Like, they're kind of all just like in that extra forward category who they're fine in a depth role as like a fill-in guy when people are injured, but they're not guys that you want to rely on to, you know, be trying to win a Stanley Cup with. And they've all played, a lot of them have played significant number of games this year, and they're not really producing much offensively.
Yeah, which I think that in itself is a reason why it's impressive. Your team still, if I remember correctly, last time I looked at the standings, 3 out of the wild card, I think, behind the Detroit Red Wings point-wise. I think it's 33-30 points.
Yeah, we have 5 games in hand now on the Red Wings, and we are 3 points back.
Okay, yeah, so you're 3 games out of a playoff spot. So, like, I think that's impressive when you don't have all the things happening, like you said, particularly a guy that you would think you could count on more, who since the start of his career really has been disappointing, is Jake DeBrusque, where he started off hot, the 14th overall and 15th, and then he just all of a sudden hasn't found that same, how, like, they call it the fairy dust or the magic dust, whatever you want to call it. He hasn't found it since then. So for you, like, what do you think even is realistic to even obtain at this point? Because he has, let's see, he's an RFA after this year, so yeah. 3.675, so it's whatever the rest of that would be for this year the team would have to pay. But what do you think is realistic? Because he has an expiring contract, he's an RFA, and a team's not going to want to have to overpay him in his RFA deal either with the way he's producing. So it depends how that goes with his agent. I'm not sure who his agent is, but...
Yeah, I don't expect much for DeBrusque. I honestly think the Bruins might get more than what I'm expecting because it does seem like there are some teams interested. But, I mean, I would be happy with, like, a mid-round pick for him. He's just falling completely flat on his face. He played a little bit better as of late. The last few games before the Bruins got their season paused, he was actually playing better. He scored a couple goals on the most recent road trip. He's got 5 goals now on the season, but still a massive disappointment compared to what he was supposed to be. And it's been all downhill since 2019 for Jake DeBrusque. I mean, this was a guy that we all thought was going to be a 30-goal guy and a guy that would play on the second line and be 30 goals, 60 points year in and year out and, you know, be a really good goal scorer. And it's just been an absolute disaster since 2019 for him. And he continues to still really, I mean, he's played a little better this year, certainly better this year than last year. Last year was an absolute train wreck, but still very disappointing. And I would be happy with a mid-round pick for him. I feel like maybe they might be able to get a little more than that. It seems like there are some other teams that are pretty interested in, you know, bring him in. Maybe they can get a roster player for him, but I don't know. I would just take what I can get if I'm the Bruins and move on because he has been absolutely brutal the past 2 seasons.
I feel like the people that would give more are probably thinking their coaching obviously is going to get in there with him or the people he's matched with. Like you see Zegers with Milano.
Yeah.
How much that's making Milano. Like if you see, like if they just think he's going to work really well with somebody, that's kind of why you would get maybe like a third or something along those lines rather than like a fifth or something along those lines. But
yeah.
Somebody of a no name other than Anton Blee, somebody that I saw that's been around the minors since getting drafted by, I want to say, Calgary's organization. I always mix up drafty teams at times. But I thought one random guy that's looked all right in 20 games is also Lazar for your team when he's had to play because I don't expect much. Like, if you call up Curtis Lazar, I'm not expecting a lot. I'm expecting fill in the bottom 6 and do what you have to do and don't do anything bad.
Well, no, I think Lazar's
and
been
I thought
really
he's
good.
Actually looked good, yeah. Where, like, he's kind of been your on steroids version of how Zornik's looked for the Islanders because Lazar is kind of like the hockey guy mentioned. He's a prime example of someone that might never have gotten a chance to resurrect his NHL career again if the times were normal and he didn't have to be played as much. Where with the way that things went, he got overplayed early. Zornik got overplayed. You have kind of career AHLers because they didn't figure it out with their former teams now having a chance in the NHL again, and maybe they're actually latch on because, like you said, he's doing pretty good. So that's a positive thing.
Yeah, I mean, Lazar's been a regular in the lineup since the Bruins have got him. I mean, I don't look at him in the same way as, like, the Bleeds and the Kuhlmans and the guys that have kind of been career minor leaguers because he's been a regular in the lineup ever since he's come to Boston. He was a regular for Buffalo as well, where we got him from. But, yeah, I mean, he's played well. He's been one of my favorite fourth-line additions to this team ever since the trade at the deadline last year. And he brings a solid game. He's got some offensive ability. You know, he plays hard. And I like Curtis Lazar a lot. He really, you know, got back on track in Buffalo. and then now coming to Boston has had an opportunity to have a regular spot in the lineup that he didn't really have in his last year in Calgary. So, yeah, it's been an interesting career for him. He was a regular with Ottawa for a couple seasons, then kind of fell out of favor with the Sens and got sent back down. Then had one good year with the Flames out of three, and then ended up kind of resurrecting with the Sabres. And then ever since coming to Boston, he's been a fixture on that fourth line. And I think he's been one of the better bottom six guys for the Bruins, to say the least.
Yeah, that's right. You're right. Yeah, Flames was his second team. He was drafted by the Sens in the first round. So he's kind of a prime example of someone that fits into the category of he didn't live up to the pick of where he was picked, per se, if you want to go by that.
Yeah, not at all.
But he did still find himself to figure out how to become a guy that could stay. He found his niche. He said, this is the way that I'm going to stay in this league. And he just kept improving those skill sets, like being able to do everything you just said, being solid with the stick checks, the getting in the passing lanes, all that chutzpah. He found his niche just being like, I have to do everything a bottom line forward can do, and I'll be able to stick. And yeah, it's not with the pick that the Senators picked him at years ago. But he's not on the Senators anymore, so that doesn't even matter from that perspective anymore. He's now on the Bruins, and he's kicking butt in the bottom six. So that's really all that matters at this point. But, John, something for your team, though, that has been fairly successful this season. Your power play's in the top 10, and your shots on goal is in the top 10. So, obviously, those are things that you would think, especially the shots on goal, would generate a little bit to more consistent offense, because when you look at those stats, those are in the top 10. Then when you look at goals, it's 22nd. So, what do you think is a way, one, to keep the power play hot, but maybe two, to get the 5-on-5 play a little bit hotter, to not just generate shots, but also generate finishes?
Well, they just need production. I mean, they throw like 40 shots on goal per game. Like they have plenty of chances. They just don't finish. This team has no finishing ability whatsoever outside of those few star guys like Marchand and Bergeron. And even Pasternak's had a down year this year. I mean, he hasn't been bad, but it's certainly not the same level of attack. I mean, he only has 8 goals this year. It's not the same, just drive the play, attack mode, superstar scorer that we're used to seeing with David Pastrnak. It hasn't been there this year. They're really heavily relying on Marchand and Bergeron. They're the only guys on this team with double-digit goals. And they're getting no finish. Taylor Hall only has 5 goals. Jake DeBrusk only has 5 goals. Craig Smith only has 2. He's been really disappointing this year. Charlie Coyle actually has had a pretty solid year. He's got 7 goals and 14 points. But They're not getting nearly enough finish from guys outside of Marchand and Bergeron. Nobody else is scoring enough, other than maybe McAvoy with 4 from the back end and 15 points is, pretty decent. But there's just no finish with this team. They get a ton of shots. Their power play is good, and I think their power play should be even better given the roster that they have. But they're just not finishing, and I don't know if there's a quick fix for that. I mean, that's not something that you can just go out there and change. I mean, that's on your players to produce, and they're getting the chances. They're not putting them in the net, and we're seeing that across the board with this team.
Yeah, and obviously, if you're getting the chances and not putting them in a net, something you don't want to have to go along with that is your top 10, 9 in goals allowed and 7th in shots on goals allowed. Where that's a stat that I think, when I've watched a couple of your games this season, the Bruins have got harped into, because like you said, we said before the podcast, basically it's a shooting gallery in a lot of Bruins games because they get a lot of shots on net. And then the other team gets a multitude of shots on net, where with young goaltending and Swayman, and then when you have a guy in Ullmark who's just coming into being in a mecca market, he was obviously in Buffalo before, who's trying to rebuild their team to becoming that big market again. I feel like you don't want to obviously have that shot output consistently at night. What do you think? Because you obviously have some names. You have the Carlos, you have the Grizzlicks. Mike Riley has, I think, 5 points this season, hasn't been playing terrible there. Like, you have some guys on defense, but what do you think they have to do a little bit better systematically or positionally to just not allow the ridiculous amount of shot output, because if you're not finishing, you can't allow that many chances for the other team, obviously.
Yeah, see, I don't have as big of a problem with the the shot totals that they're giving up. Boston has actually been good defensively this year. They're really not giving up that many goals, but my issue with them has been the timeliness of the goals that they've given up. Like they're giving away grade A chances at the worst times, yeah, in one goal games or in tie games in the third period. They're giving up a grade A chance here and there. It always seems to come back to bite them. And the other thing that I've noticed with the Bruins a lot this year is they are giving up those cardinal sin goals that are either in the first minute of a period or the last minute of a period. And they've given up a lot of those goals this year that you're just not going to win games doing that. And I mean, overall, I don't think defense or goaltending has been the problem for this team. This team just doesn't score enough, and that's why they're not winning more games. But some of the timeliness of the goals and just the breakdowns defensively, where when they do give up a chance, they're leaving guys open in the slot. They're letting guys walk in from the top of the circle and just rip one in. Like they're giving up these really high quality, high danger chances where they just got to keep the puck to the outside. You can shoot it from the half wall 100 times a game if you want. Your goalie's going to stop that 95% of the time, but they're giving up really, high quality chances at really bad times. And it's more often than not ending up in the back of the net. And that's what's costing them games defensively.
Yeah. So it's really not a bad overall defense. It's just a bad unclutch time defense.
Yeah.
It's like the opposite.
It has been a lot this year.
Yeah. Which is not something you want to have, because you don't want to, because that's also when you see people wrongfully judge. Like we see this all the time. I mean, people have podcasts yourself, but you sometimes see people that just look at numbers wrongfully judge goalies then when teams do that, where it'll be like, well, this guy's been struggling more lately. Where then when you look at it, it's like you said, A-plus chances given up at inopportune times, unless if he dove on his stomach, like he probably wouldn't have made those types of saves. So I think as we wrap up here, though, what are your, for your Boston Bruins so far, what are your like points going forward? Like if you were in your either armchair GM seat as a GM, what would be three moves you would make in order to improve the team? And then if you were a coach, what would be three things you would tell the team that they have to do better in order to improve going forward when they come back as well?
All right. So I'll be the GM first. I'm seeing what's out. I mean, I'm on the phone trying to make this DeBrusque deal. This isn't something that needs to linger over the team and hang with them all year long. I'm on the phone trying to see what I can get for Jake DeBrusque. I'm certainly looking to add a defenseman. I don't think they're deep enough on the back end. Again, their defense hasn't been their problem. They're only giving up like 2.6 goals against per game, which is a fine number. It's not top of the league, but it's fine. But I don't think they're deep enough on the back end. And when you've got guys, like Connor Clifton playing as much as he has and John Moore having to come back into the fold on the decor, like you need another guy on the back end there. So now Boston doesn't have a whole lot of cap space to work with, which is not helpful when it comes to making these kinds of moves. But if you can get DeBrusque and his $3.6 million out of there, then you might have a little bit more money to work with to try and bring in a D-man. And any sort of third line scoring that you can get, I'm always in the market for that, particularly if you're the Bruins, where this kind of secondary scoring issue has been a problem for them for really the last number of years. This is nothing new. We thought that some of the offseason additions this year might help that, and they really haven't. Howla has been a huge disappointment. Nosek's been fine, but he doesn't bring a lot offensively. He's been good in kind of that, bottom six penalty killing energy type role, but he hasn't done a ton offensively. Foligno, as much as I love the way Nick Foligno's played, he again hasn't really produced. So secondary scoring continues to be a major issue, and that's something that if there's anything out there that can help that, maybe it's part of the DeBrusque deal. You've got to try and get some sort of like third line scoring in here. So for as far as GM goes, DeBrusque trade, finding a D-man to add some depth, and any sort of secondary scoring I could get would be my big three things.
Yeah, no, I think those are definitely the main things. Because I was going to say, when I was talking about your defense, like I thought Forbert the last couple years of his career has kind of made himself look more steady. The last, I would say, since he was 27, he's 29 now. He's kind of got more and more consistent.
I like Forbert.
Yeah, I like him.
I don't think Clifton, he's a top guy.
But. Yeah, Clifton's the guy. I think, like, you hit it on the head. He should be your seventh or like your extra eighth defenseman, not a guy that's playing 18 games already. Yeah. That is. That's why if you had, like you said, one extra person. I would agree there where I think you do need to add in one extra offensive person. And then the other thing is just the inevitable thing that's going to happen. Yeah. If I was the GM of the Bruins, as soon as he's ready to go, sign Tuukka Rask. So as soon as he says, I'm good, G, I'm signing Tuukka Rask.
Yeah,
and, and I would not care if he called me that either for that specific instance because it's Tuukka Rask coming back. So like, he could literally be Trevor Zegras in that moment. Bruh, I'm good, bruh. Dude.
Yeah.
Dude, got you, dude. Like, and I wouldn't care at all. So, but what would be your coaching adjustments if you had to look at the season? If you were in Bruce Cassidy's shoes, what would be your coaching adjustments to say with the roster you have now, like the Studnikas when they're playing – like the Fredericks of the world, what would you do to kind of get the dirty but good goals a little bit more since you have to get the offense go?
You just got to, everybody's got to be crashing the net with this team. Boston is not a talented enough team to walk down the ice and snipe it, you know, top corner. Like that, that's not how the Bruins are going to score goals. This is not a flashy team. This is not an overly skilled team. This is a team that needs to throw the puck on the net and then have 3 to 4 guys there in front of that net, just digging away, trying to find a rebound, trying to get a deflection in front. You are not going to score pretty goals if you're the Boston Bruins. Maybe your top line will from time to time. Sure. I mean, they're all great players, but for this team, the emphasis has to be just get the puck on net, which hasn't really been an issue. They're shooting a ton this year, but they got to crash that net, find the rebound, and score those dirty net front goals, because that's really the only way this team is going to score this year, at least for a majority of these players. So they've got to go to the net.
Yeah, I think what you said is get the dirty rebound goals. They've been getting enough pucks on net. Yeah. You haven't always been having enough people slide behind the defender to then get to the puck. I mean, as it's getting on net.
The Bruins are getting a lot of shots, but the goals, they're not high danger shots. They're not quality scoring chances, and the goaltender's just making the first save and the puck's getting cleared out of the zone. So in that aspect, shots really don't matter. Like, you need the first shot, and then you need chance 2 and 3 coming after that first shot with guys in front of the net. And that's what Boston's not getting nearly enough of.
Yeah, and that's why I agree, because guys like Frederick, like, he's a perfect player, an example. When you looked at him coming up the ranks, he did stand in front of a net.
Yep.
And he was a guy that you would use to kind of play that role, that he could block out the front of the net, get a deflection goal, or get those dirty but good goals that you saw for all those years with different guys that played for Boston, and also something that Nick Foligno's been great at his career in Columbus. So, like,
yeah, and he doesn't have a goal yet this year.
Exactly. So, like, that's an oddity for him. Like, it's weird for him to be this deep into a season and not have that. So, like, I think if you can get those guys going, because it's kind of like the same thing in hockey when you can sometimes get the first goal, like, get that monkey off your back. It's the same thing when you haven't got a hit 20 games in baseball, where you're just like, oh, God. And then all of a sudden you like just adjust and you're playing like your normal self again. Well, I feel like the Bruins, like you hinted at, you have a lot of guys struggling. If they can come back, maybe being able to kind of clear their head and getting this longer break than they would have had, maybe that will help some guys like that. But if they can come back and kind of have that good first or second game, that can really help a long way in getting things pushing in the right direction until you make other moves, like you were saying, to go out, add an extra D-man, add extra depth scoring. And obviously you're going to sign, unless if something happens between now and then, you're going to sign Tuukka back to have a net. So I think they're moving in a good direction with all the stuff they had to go through with COVID, with the and everything, and that guy's underperforming that you brought in, like Smith. Foligno is playing well structurally. Same with, like you talked about, with what's his name?
Nosek,
but he's just not producing points. You have guys that play good in a system, but you don't have enough guys, like you said, that produce the bottom level scoring. So once you find that, I think they definitely have a chance, because it seems like Detroit and others eventually will probably fall back too, and then that'll give you an opportunity to make up some standing points too. Like, surprise teams don't typically surprise for the entire NHL season. Mm-hmm. Not always, usually at least. Where we'll have to see what happens there. But do you have any closing up points or anywhere where people can find you? You can share now. I really thank you for joining us today, though.
Yeah, of course. Thanks for having me on. You can find me, obviously, on YouTube, Off the Wall Hockey. My Twitter page is Off the Wall Hawk. Facebook is Off the Wall Hockey. Instagram is OTW Hockey. And, of course, steelflyers.com. Everything is on all aggregated there as well. So you can see everything at Steel Flyers. And, yeah, just hoping that the Bruins can kind of play to their potential. Because, you know, when you look at this roster and what they have and when they're healthy, they have a good team to put on the ice. And they've showed it at points this season. They've really looked like a contender at certain points. And then other times they look like they're not even going to make the playoffs. And it's really that inconsistency that's been so frustrating with the Bruins this year. I just want to see them play to their potential and play to the level that roster is capable of playing at. And I certainly think they're going to be a playoff team if they can do that, but they've got to try and find some consistency and play at that level on a more regular basis than what they have for the first part of the year.
Yeah, they kind of been similar to how in the West, like, you're kind of the East team that has the inconsistencies. A team in the West, because of their goaltending and all of that, like, similar to how we talk about the Bruins, is kind of the Jets, where you've seen them go like this. Yep. Where you look at the roster and go, well, what the hell's wrong with this team? They should be
way more consistent
than they are. Yeah, yep. Like, it's kind of, that's why I feel like with this team, like I said, once people bounce back in, if they can get a couple hot games going, I feel like you're flipped with Detroit on the wild card eventually, and then you just keep going up from there, and then whatever happens there. It's like Boudreau said is my closing point when he came into the Canucks. You just have to have a winning season from here on out.
Yep.
Forget everything that happened before now. Just have a winning season from here on out and keep that mentality in your head, and you're never going to get held back by past failures.
Yep.
So you just got to keep that going, basically. But you can find me as well at Steel Flyers and at JJBoer26 on Twitter as well as here. Please continue to subscribe, everybody. We really appreciate you. Have a good and blessed happy holidays as well. Stay safe out there, everybody, and enjoy the hockey.